honorable principal of our Gudlavaleru Engineering College, Dr. P. Ravindra Babu, eminent vice principal academics, Dr. G. Prasad, veteran vice principal administration, Dr. B. Karun Kumar, esteemed resource person of the today's webinar, Dr. Rama Matthew, distinguished ELTC Center Director Dr. P. Ramanujam, HODs of different departments, Dr. Lino Mukhopadhyaya, Dr. Jacob Tharu, and my dear colleagues of the department, the coordinators Mr. Rajkumar and Mr. Rajkiran, and all the advisors and principals of our sister institutes, and the enthusiastic participants, good morning, every one of you. I welcome you all to this webinar on transformative assessment by Dr. Rama Matthew. And before we begin this session, I would like to have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Rama Matthew to you. Dr. Rama Matthew is an ELT consultant and retired as professor of education from the University of Delhi, where she was also dean of the Faculty of Education. She taught at the EFL University, Hyderabad for several years. She was head of the Research, Monitoring and Evaluation Unit of English in Action Project in Bangladesh. She has been involved in several teacher development and assessment projects and published articles and books in the area. She was lead mentor for ARMS Action Research Mentoring Scheme and for ELT RMS ELT Research Mentoring Scheme, both British Council funded schemes. Currently, she is supporting teachers in Sierra Leone to carry out classroom-based research. Her research interests include language assessment, teaching English to young learners, CPD of teachers, multilingual education, and making English accessible to learners online. Now, I would take the pleasure of inviting Dr. Rama Matthew to conduct the session. Ma'am, could you please conduct the session? Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I'll just share my slide. Before I do that, I would like to thank your college, Gudlavaleru College, and also you in particular, because you have taken so much trouble to set all this up. And I'm sure it's going to be very, very useful to all the participants, all the 4-day sessions. And also a special thanks to Mr. Rajkumar, who has painstakingly helped us to set all this up, and then also use a new tool, Microsoft Teams, I had not used before. So there is so much to learn. So thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Shall I show you the screen now?
Please, please, ma'am. Yeah.
So can you all hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay, and can you see the screen?
Yes, madam.
Okay. Okay, so this is the topic for today's session, transformative assessment. I'll just tell you what this title is about and where it came from. I just want to explain a little bit about what is transformative. Of course, we know the meaning. It's a marked change in someone or something that makes them especially better. So if we are transformative teachers, then we can bring about change in probably our students and ourselves, and also help them to improve. So that's the word transformative. And it also could be a revolutionary change. Now, I believe that assessment can be transformative because assessment really is a trigger for doing many things, and then for both students and teachers. And therefore, I really like the term transformative assessment, but I give all the credit to this famous assessment expert, Popham, who actually has written a book called Transformative Assessment. In fact, I'm going to use a little bit of what he has said about transformative assessment from there. But just before that, I also will be using ideas from others, which sort of go in the same direction as transformative assessment, and I hope whatever I have put together today will be of use to you. What is our context now, which is online and offline teaching, learning and assessment? Online because of the present situation especially, and offline because we have been offline or face-to-face teachers and students most of our lives. We are quite familiar with, I'm talking to a group of teachers, therefore I'm saying we are quite familiar with and have first-hand experience of offline or face-to-face. I'm using this interchangeably, face-to-face teaching. And many of us, probably not all of us, have also been using online modes to make our teaching richer, more interesting, fun, etc., and things available to learners. But having said that, I should add that many of us are also not very comfortable using online resources because probably we are traditionally oriented, or we have been taught through the face-to-face or the old chalk and talk method and lectures and tutorials and things like that, everything face-to-face, and we believe, what's wrong in that? I learned quite well, and therefore why should I, you know, take this extra trouble to use online materials? But at the same time, there are others, even much before COVID happened, in the last 20 years or so, who have thought of blended learning, which is a good combination of online and offline, and also other resources, other methods like flipped classroom and many others. So we have, we have been using a lot of these things, Google Classroom, Zoom, Skype, Moodle, and other LMSs, learning management systems, depending on how resourceful I am as a teacher or my institution is, and whether the learner has access to it. I must add here that largely I can see that more than 50% or even 60-70% of our learners may not have access to internet or a computer. This is especially true when they don't come to college. Many of them have phones, but I don't know if they all have connectivity and how far they are using it. But at the same time, we have lots of evidence to show that learners access phones very skillfully and very creatively, and are learning quite a lot and having fun with it. Therefore, we have to keep that in mind. In the present context, of course, there is a compulsion to use these mediums to do what we did offline and probably go beyond. Now, this is what I would like to underline, go beyond. And I believe that this current COVID situation is a temporary one and it will finish. I am very optimistic. But I think this is a good opportunity, this what's going on now, what we are all doing. For example, the way this webinar has been set up, and I don't know how many people have signed up for that, but the fact that it's being made accessible shows that we are thinking on new lines and new ways, and making things that we know each are sharing with others what we know and so on. So this is a very good thing. So it is a very good opportunity for us to try out things that we wouldn't have tried out if the situation had happened. So now I'm going to talk about formative assessment a little bit, because that's what is in the teacher's hands. That's what the teacher is able to carry out, change, or the way she wants and so on. So usually the kinds of formative assessment that we have been doing is paper pencil tests, a lot of it, where there's a focus on reading, writing, grammar, vocabulary. It can't be more than this, unfortunately. And hopefully, I think Leena Mukhopadhyay talked about this yesterday, we are not testing memory. When we say reading, I hope we are testing unseen reading, reading comprehension, writing, which is not rehearsed, grammar and vocabulary, which sort of is relevant in a context where we, meaningful context, where we do reading and writing, speaking and listening, and not just grammar vocabulary for its own sake. I hope we are doing that. Then we are also doing, I think, a lot of speaking tests, listening tests, quizzes, projects that focus on integrating reading, researching, writing, discussion, presentation, etc. It's a very good thing to integrate reading and research, reading, writing, and all the other skills, because that then they resemble real life tasks. That's how you usually function. We, even in our academic context, when we are reading, we are also making notes. So when we are reading, we are comprehending, and then we turn it into an essay. We use that reading information from the reading to write an essay or to discuss or to present an argument and so on. So very often it's very integrated. And like Lena said yesterday, it's good to focus on these, and then the necessary grammar and vocabulary will, relevant vocabulary will emerge from these integrative tasks. So I think we have been doing this. If you're not, then from Lena's session yesterday and from what I'm going to do now, you can start using these. And just to mention, you don't have to actually create new tests at all. A lot of it is available online. You just have to click and just search, and you will be bombarded with many, many different kinds of items at different levels, and even speaking and listening and everything. So what is it we want to look at now? Did we do meaningful, credible, fair assessments in our regular F2F is face-to-face classes? It's time to think now. When we are in this online mode, it's good to think back about what we have been doing so far, and then also look at whether these assessments that we have been doing are meaningful, meaningful as in more real life task than just doing some kind of discrete point tests. Credible, are they reliable, are they valid, is it fair to the student, and so on. I think Lena also talked about this a little bit yesterday. The other thing is, now we have to look at is, now what is the scenario like? How shall we do assessments that are even better than what we did earlier? So I'm really focusing on this. I believe that we can do things better than we did in the face-to-face situation, especially assessment and teaching. So how shall we do that? That's the question. Okay, coming to formative assessment, FA as it's all called. I'm sorry to say, at the school level, it's much abused, not understood, distorted, call it whatever you like. In fact, the CBSE even went to the extent of withdrawing formative assessment and giving weight to it. So that, let's not talk about that now. Now, what FA is, what is it about? If instruction is the means to a curricular end, that is, that's what we do, instruction as in teaching, because that's how we get across things to our students in order to achieve some curricular aims. If that is the means, then FA is a process intended to make a teacher's instructional means more effective. So it's a very, very crucial and integral part of instruction. So it's a process, and it will definitely make the instructional means more effective. And therefore, I should do FA in a very, very effective way. So it's almost like a corollary. FA seems to be the kind of, the tool, a powerful tool that will help me do my instruction more effectively and achieve the goals, curricular goals. So we are going to talk a little bit about formative assessment now. But then, as Popham indicates, formative assessment is not instruction. Very often when we are teaching, of course, we are looking for evidence of how my class is going on. Did I ask the right question? Did I say things in a way that students can understand? So I'm always looking for ways and means of finding out whether I'm making sense. So it is very closely aligned with teaching, this formative assessment. Yet, it is not equal to teaching. FA is a separate sort of activity. It's a process, of course, very closely interlinked with teaching, but then it's a separate one. And that separate bit is what we are going to examine. Let's look at this now. I just want to, for a minute, pause and then look at this one. What are our goals for teaching and learning? One thing is to make learners more competent in a chosen area of study. Now, we can focus here on English as a language. There may be in the audience teachers who are not English teachers, but they are subject teachers like science teachers, mathematics teachers, and political science, and so on. But our aim is to make our students competent in the subject that they have chosen. We also want to promote learner autonomy, which is making the learner self-reliant, making the learner learn by himself or herself. And why is our autonomy important? Because we are not there all the time to keep teaching them. We should not, in fact, keep teaching them. It's like spoon feeding. When the baby is small, we feed the baby, and then we very much want the baby to be on his or her own very quickly. Otherwise, we'll be feeding this child who becomes an adult throughout their life, imagine. So it's almost like that. So we do want learners to become self-dependent so that they can go and look for whatever they want to study and understand and apply and do and think about and be critical about and everything. So we have to let the learner become independent. That's one of the crucial goals. If only after giving them competence, next, according to me, comes autonomy. If we are going to make them dependent on us, I'm sorry, I take this very strong view that we are not doing a good job. Okay, then the third thing, according to me, is collaborate. I think collaborative learning and collaborative living are so very important part of our lives. So we begin this collaborative learning in the school, in the college classroom itself, and we have to share. Collaboration, I also contrast with competition. Of course, we all know that in our education system, there's a lot of competition as opposed to collaboration. Very often students behave as though if they share what they know, the other person will steal it and go away with it, and then they will do better than this person and so on. But I think we are wrong there. The more I share, the more I collaborate, the more I learn, the more I'm richer. I'm richer by that process. So we need to really promote this in the classroom. Of course, many of us, In the face-to-face situation, we do a lot of pair work, group work, discussions and everything, where we say, now get together, and together you come to a understanding of whatever. And then all the people are putting their heads together. So it is like saying two heads are better than one. I don't know how many of us are really genuinely helping our children to become collaborative. I think we need to try even harder. Of course, this is not all about the goals. You can add many others. Yeah, I'm just looking at these three because these are, according to me, very crucial. When I say competent, just to clarify this, competent at all levels of learning, right from simple understanding to becoming very critical, very analytical, very simple. All that kind of thing. So in this competence is involved all levels of learning, even to the highest level. I just watched a workshop, online webinar. It was not a webinar. It's a call it what you like. This is a link. This is a British Council conducted one, and it was titled Online Workshops, Content Process and Delivery. Very well done, and one can learn a lot from this. So I'm going to give you some more links to things that we can all go back and look at and learn from. Again, one more thing is learning is continuous. It's lifelong, and therefore we have to have the tools to keep ourselves learning. Therefore, this is very important. Okay, now here is a diagram, not as complicated as it seems probably. It's a four-step process for formative assessment. Okay, having looked at the main goals that we want to achieve and many other goals that we might want to achieve, and having looked at the importance of formative assessment, which means we are trying to improve our instruction, we are going to adjust our instruction in a way that our students are continuing to learn. How do we do this four-step formative assessment? Imagine a class where the teacher is teaching, maybe through a kind of interactive lecture method, and then she has certain ideas or goals about what she wants to do that day. So as she does that, apart from asking questions to check their understanding every now and then, she will have to set up, she'll have to identify some assessment occasions. What do we mean by this? They'll have to be points during the talk, during the class, may not be that day's class, but immediately in the second class maybe, but then even within the class, I think there will be points which are very crucial, which will tell her whether students have understood or not. And if they haven't understood something up to that point, then she will have to do something about it. She'll have to adjust. She'll have to do something more. So you identify an occasion during your teaching when you have to get an idea, get evidence from the students about how well they are learning. So that you need to identify that occasion. Then you need to think of what kind of procedure you want to use to find out whether they are learning, whether they have sort of they've stopped paying attention, or they are lost somewhere. That you need to say. So assessment procedure. Then you apply that assessment procedure and look for evidence. So all these are sort of systematically set up. It's not a fleeting kind of a process. And then depending on what the evidence says, if most of them have not learned something for you to go on to the next step, then you need to make instructional adjustments. We'll see what those instructional adjustments are. And then you again go from here, the beginning. So every class of yours, every input that you have planned, will have to have these four-step process. Now about Popham, in fact, says that just asking a question to two or three people, did you understand, or what do you think happened? And one student answers it, and then another student says, no, I think it is this. And then you say, okay, now it looks like the class is with me. The class is, following what I'm trying to say. Now, I think that is not sufficient. That's because you haven't got evidence from everybody. Just one or two students, very often the same students will answer. Sometimes after one student answers, half the other one just adds to it. That does not show full understanding of it at all. So questioning, while it may seem like it's a very important technique, just random asking of questions to just throwing it open to the class is not what we are saying is a procedure. You might be very observant, of course you should be, and it's very, very important, but that's again not enough. You might make wrong decisions, is what Popham says. And I tend to agree with him to a large extent, but there are some issues, but let's see how we can deal with this. So questioning, observation, being very astute in your instructional techniques, everything is very important, but not sufficient to do formative assessment, which is made up of four steps. So if you have, just to go back to that question you may have asked in the class, if you have given the question on the board and then get them to answer, each one of them to answer and show it you while you're teaching, then that is a good procedure. How will they show? They can hold up some their answer. They can be color-coded cards. Suppose they show to yes, it could be a yes-no question. Suppose for yes, they'll show a red card and sorry, a green card, and for a no, they show a red card or something. Some evidence you will have to have from each one. And then, of course, there is an important question about how many people should show positive evidence of learning for you to go on without making adjustments. How many, and then what should you do? So definitely if all 100% of your class, that is all the 40 or 50 of them, show understanding at that point where which you have set up as an assessment occasion, then of course you are happy and you will proceed. But if 50 of them show understanding, 50 of them don't, what should you do? Again, you know, Dylan William is a very famous person for formative assessment. We all believe that 50 is no good, maybe 80, maybe 90, and so on. Also, I think we should very quickly add, it depends on how important this topic for what we have chosen to teach that day. If it's something that is weaker, it will happen in a research day, maybe you can let go with it. But if it's something very crucial without which the next bit of lesson becomes difficult to teach, then you had better aim for 70 or 80% of understanding at that point. And then what is making instructional adjustment? Instructional adjustment is maybe you thought you went too fast. You can ask them, you can go on getting feedback about this and then do it slightly slowly, or you can give more examples, or you can reteach. Very often reteaching is probably not the best. Very often teachers say, okay, you want me to say this again, and they say that. But then you don't know still whether that's a good thing. So you actually, it depends on the teacher. The teacher will have to be quite the teacher in picking out things that she probably did something which she did not want to, and therefore this non-learning has happened. And so this is very, you know, slightly vague post-step process. So let me demonstrate this as an example. I thought I'll use Lina's example. Lina showed those who were present, I think those who are not, I'll just tell you what example is like. It's basically writing stuff. And probably you can even a portfolio with time. So it's a longish task, that is the main thing. And then it can be split up into smaller bits. And that's what you will see in these boxes one. The easiest or the simplest would be write a response to a prompt, maybe response to a question, could be a small writing task, and the speech has been. Now, this could be an occasion, like I said, assessment occasion. Now, at the end of one, could be an assessment occasion, which you will try to find out how to test. They have already written that. How will you examine whether they have got it right in order to go on to the next step? Now, second, you must revise based on the test. Here, you have given some kind of condition, unmediated condition. So the teacher has given some feedback, and just the teacher gives feedback. And then they just revise. Now, this could be the adjustment that or be trying to understand their students can be better, therefore you can get so they on the basis of that decide. But I must now tell you that it's not the core very clearly they could
excuse me, madam.
Yeah.
Excuse me, madam.
Yeah.
There is a problem with your voice, madam.
Oh. Now can you hear me?
I can hear you. Is there any noise at
no.
your place, ma'am?
No noise at all.
No noise at all. Okay. Now it's okay, madam. It's okay.
Okay. Okay. Can you all hear me now?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'm sorry about that. Okay. I just want to tell you that this. Each one is not one. It could be the occasion that you have identified, but it could be an integration of 3-4 steps inside it. Or what I'm trying to get at is there is a kind of a progression that I can see from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, and this could as well be maybe not just 4 classes, many more classes, and some work to be done at home. But then you can see some kind of how the teacher is looking for evidence and then doing something, all ending with this kind of writing portfolio. Now, along with writing, of course, reading and listening, many other things are happening as part of the course. But then here we are looking at the writing continuum. In the writing continuum, how do you expect the kind of occasion, assessment occasion, when they write a response, you have got an assessment occasion and a procedure, and then you will you have got evidence for that, and then you will adjust your teaching, as in give unmediated revision, unmediated feedback, and then they write another response, maybe an extension of the topic, and then here they all get together. And then, you know, revise it together, maybe peer groups revise it together because they all have all got different kinds of feedback and so on. So here they also understand how best, the feedback can be used. So I also want to underline the fact that here bringing in peer groups, I think, is a very good thing because you want to focus on collaboration. It need not, and then depending on the teacher feedback, again, is as I was referring to it, trying to make them autonomous. Collaboration will take you towards that rather than when only the teacher gives feedback. Also remember, when only the teacher gives feedback, very often students don't understand it, maybe, or students think, okay, I should do what the teacher says because that's when I can get a better grade. So all these are issues you'll need to take care of that. So in the discussion we can see how we can think of other examples where we can understand the 4-step formative assessment process. Now what I want to do is what's going on? It's got stuck. Raja, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
I'm not able to move the move this. It's not going. I don't know what has happened. Okay, it's gone. Okay, now I just wondered, I want to give 2 minutes. If you have questions, can you put it down in the Q&A box at this point? Up to now, whatever we have said. I'll just give you 1 minute, maybe. Is that okay? Is that okay? Raja, is that possible? Can they put down questions at this point? Okay. Now I want to go on to something else from where we can draw some lessons, which is about this experiment. Hole in the wall. It's called Hole in the Wall experiment done by Sugata Mitra. I don't know how many of you have heard of this experiment or listened to his presentation or, you know, seen this this YouTube TED talk, an excellent one. You can watch it. And there are many other talks that he has given. So I want to just look at this and see what we can draw from here. Sugata Mitra, who was in Delhi for many years in the during 1999 and, you know, some more years, he did an experiment in the suburban areas of Delhi, where he thought, you know, they were not in government schools. Many teachers were absent. There was absenteeism, as well as not in, all teachers were recruited. So children were without teachers and so on. So he thought, he used to work for NIIT then. So he went and put a small computer, embedded it in the wall, and then left it there in the outskirts of Delhi. Outskirts are the suburban areas of Delhi. And then he saw that it was at the level, at a physical level where students, children could reach. And it had internet. And then by evening, he saw that there were quite a few students, you know, meddling with it, looking at it, learning from it, and collaborating there among themselves. And it was amazing for him. I just want to show you some pictures before I do this. This is what he did. This is the kind of computer he put. And you can see a student or a boy from the village is trying to figure out what's going on there. And this boy is supposed to have said, I didn't know you could do with you could do things with a TV. This TV listens to you, or this TV, you know, is doing things according to your instruction. And then many other boys joined him here in the second picture. And then by evening, there were quite a few. And then here again, in another place, children are trying to see, understand, and doing lots of things. This I'll tell you a little later. Now, he figured out one thing. He left computers like this in many places in around Delhi. And then he saw that these children were doing things on their own. And then he figured out probably absence of a teacher might assist learning, because there was no adult. Adults were not allowed. There were some guys standing near it who made sure that the adult didn't come near the children. It was all children. And they did not know what a computer was, what internet was, and nothing they knew. But by evening, they had figured out how the computer works. So he came up with this kind of a proposition that probably the teacher's intervention may not be the best. Its impact can interfere with learning. So he came up with this proposal that absence of a teacher might assist learning. And then what's the other thing he did? He figured out that self-organized learning environment is very, very conducive. He called it SOL. That is, they themselves in heterogeneous groups organize themselves, and then they are helping each other. What one doesn't know, the other helps with, and so on. So this way, they were not only playing games and downloading things and looking at news and looking at other things, they also were learning things that they thought is interesting. So they were doing a lot of very productive work. And he also found that they were in heterogeneous groups because that's how it was organized, in the sense many children came there, small, big, and somebody who knew more than others and so on. And then it's unsupervised. Nobody is telling them what's wrong, what's right, what should they not do, nothing. And on a large screen, he said, this is what he did and it seemed to work, and therefore he's recommending this kind of thing. It's not a tiny little bit, it's not a phone. And those days, of course, we didn't have this kind of phone. So on a large screen. And then the other thing, what did they learn? For example, they didn't know English at all, but then in about 8 days or so, they were using quite a bit of English. they had figured out American English versus British English because the computer gave them all kinds of programs. He also tested them on vocabulary, and he said in 8 days they were using more than 200 words in their vocabulary, in their active use. So they were quite conversant with the English language. It didn't take them very long. Also, he posed questions like, can anything be in two places at the same time? This was in an experiment done in England later on. This experiment, which began in India, spread to other places, to many, many countries now more recently. So he asked this question to some children, can anything be in two places at the same time? And then, of course, they didn't know physics or anything like that, but they had figured out, he gave them 15 minutes. They figured out, and they said, Sugata, have you heard of quantum entanglement? And that was it, he says. That was really the kind of notion, that was the concept. So they were able to figure out things, although they hadn't done any physics curriculum according to grade 5, 6, 7, 8. I don't know when quantum entanglement is a topic or is a concept that you learn. So he believed, he says he's not an educationist, he's a physicist, but then he's trying to figure out how learning happens. And he says that learning is very difficult to understand. It's very complex. It's not as simple as you just teach this curriculum and then you go and test it and they learn it. It's not so simple. So he's saying even without the basic understanding of physics, they could figure out this very complex concept, which was quantum entanglement. Later on, of course, he goes on to saying, should curriculum be organized the way it is organized at all, and so on. He won a TED Talk award, and then that made him carry out such experiments all over the world, actually. So he has in fact come a long way in the sense he has figured out many new things and many other things. And he's carrying out this experiment. He also said one more thing. One thing that you could do is use the grandmother method of appreciating. When a child does something, the grandfather figure or grandmother, she or he is likely to say, oh, very good, so well done. Then the child is likely to say, no, you don't know what, I'll show you something more. So that, provides some kind of encouragement to the child to continue doing things and do many more complex things and so on. So he called it the granny cloud. So he says, yeah, some kind of adult appreciation is a good thing, but not intervention and not appreciating on a regular basis or anything like that. So he also said, can there be a school in the cloud? So they don't have to come to school. When government school children came to school or didn't come to school, not much learning happened. But then this way they were learning a lot. So he poses lots of very significant questions for us to look at. He talked about the school in the cloud. So this TED Talk is available here. I'm just giving you this link, but there are many other TED Talks. Trying to draw, and then, yeah, this is another village. So in Sundarbans, but by then they had got a building because he had got a lot of money. He put up these computers and then got children to explore it themselves. He also found over 10 years of experimentation that their using devices ability had gone up, has shot up like this. If you look at this graph here, first graph. And then the internet searching skills again had improved quite a lot. You can see that. And all this is unsupervised, untaught, uninstructed. Then a byproduct, he says, is almost like an incidental learning. Their reading comprehension had improved everywhere quite a bit because they were reading instructions, they were reading things that came up on the screen, and they had figured out listening strategies, reading strategies, everything. This reading, it had gone up. So now a new kind of literacy had emerged through self-organizing systems, according to him. This I thought was very significant for us. Coming to assessment, which is our topic for today, He's quite unhappy with the way we do assessments. It's quite out of date, he says. Out of date, why? Because we are training our students in this exam hall, or assessing their abilities in this exam hall to fit into an office which does not exist anymore. This is an office which existed in the early 20th century, in 1900. So he says all people are dead here. So why are we preparing students to go into an office which does not exist? It is obsolete. So this does make sense to me, because what we are testing, is it all necessary for our real life, for jobs, for future purposes? So this question we need to really ask. This, of course, he's quite critical about this. So he says assessment needs to change. What should it try and find out? To solve problems when they appear. It's not to solve problems just in case it appears. So he gives this example. It's not just in case. This is the kind of testing we do, but just in time. Can the internet be allowed to? Can mobile phones be allowed in exams? What kind of exam should be set up for that? And then it is very real life. We are testing them for real life. So this is the example. In fact, he mentions one example, which is a quadratic equation. And he says, we are testing them on quadratic equation. What if we encounter it one day suddenly? Now that's, of course, more like a joke. But then, yeah, there are many things like quadratic equations we teach and test, all for just in case we might need. So his proposal is about initiating change, introduce the internet as a formal subject in school. This can be learned but not taught. It changes too fast. Introduce complex dynamical system as a subject through simulation, experiments, and social science. So they should understand the processing of internet or the processing of a computer that they need to learn, not just get to know how to use a computer. That's very important. But this is a very interesting suggestion he gives. Divide existing curriculum into three parts. One should be necessary for life. The other one is feels good to know. The example he gives is of our solar system. It's good to know for stargazers. Now there's a comet in the sky in Hyderabad, for example. And it's good to know these kinds of things. So do give that kind of curriculum as well. And also you can, if you have to, have things only for exams, but then let them also know that they will forget it as soon as the exam is over, which is what most of us have been through. We hate exams and we forget what we did in the exam, and then we start learning for life. So that doesn't have to happen. So at least if you have to do this kind of exam, divide it into three parts. Allow the use of the internet, during examinations, because you don't need to know how to tell time without looking at your watch. So that's the example he gives. For most things we can use internet, so why do we not allow internet in the exam? That's about the experiment. Now I want to sum up. So what are we saying? Although teaching and learning looks like a neat design where we plan, teach and assess what we think we have taught, it's not a teach is equal to learn system at all. Just think of how many times you may have intervened and stopped our students from learning. Very seriously, please think of this. Because we know that everything that we so-called teach is not learned. In fact, I'm reminded of this article by Dick Allwright, very old, but then very relevant even today. He wrote this article, "Why Don't Learners Learn What Teachers Teach?" A very interesting article. He found that they had learned something else other than what teachers had taught. How did that happen? Or at least they said they didn't learn that, what teachers taught. So there is some kind of a mystery. There's some kind of a magic going on there. And then, of course, he came up with this learner's agenda hypothesis. So learners have an agenda, just like teachers have an agenda, their plan to teach. They have a plan to learn. So we'll have to consider their agenda as well. Looking for evidence is crucial, not just for what we have taught, but for other things as well. Look for evidence, but you know, I'm not prepared to believe that we can just gauge everything with our eyes. You also have to look at the heart. And I was just very tempted to take this from the Little Prince storybook. If you have not read it, please read it. Eyes are blind, you have to look with the heart. So you can be very astute, you can look at their eyes, but then they don't say everything. You will have to really try to get to their heart in several different ways. Can students tell us and demonstrate what they have learned? Because now, especially in the internet age, in COVID times, they are accessing lots and lots of things, lots and lots of important information, resources, everything. So they're learning a lot. Can they tell us what they have learned? Can they demonstrate it? Can they make their own tests, assessment tools? I've tried this and it really works. When you tell them to make their own test based on what they have learned, maybe you will have not 40 tests, but at least 20 tests in a class of 40, but it's worth that effort. Then let them administer it to themselves. You can help them to fine tune it or whatever, but then that tells you a lot more than what test you have conducted. Can exams be open book and then internet based? Not for just in case, but for just in time. So this way we can have lots of ideas about what students really know and what they have learned. One is to carefully monitor it in the classroom through formative assessment, like the example I tried to show you. But in these times at least, and I hope we don't go back to the boring face-to-face class where only the teacher lectures and we have to listen, the students have to listen, but we will continue using these tools, internet-based tools, and therefore we'll need to think of assessments which go beyond what we have been doing. There are online courses, aplenty, MOOCs. For example, Coursera, Harvard University, British Council, Yale University, they have all floated free online courses. And there are courses which will fall in your area of expertise. For example, I started doing one on how to teach online. Very interesting, just some 6 hours or so over 4 weeks. If you can spend 2 hours a week, you can learn quite a lot. And the other thing I'm looking at is learning to learn. So how do we get our learners to learn on their own? How do we learn to be on our own? So these are very useful. We need to look at this. That's all I have. But before we conclude, I just want you to read this quotation. It's from Paulo Freire about teaching and learning, the kind of interrelationship there is between teaching and learning. This is very important. Of course, there is no teaching without learning, but whoever teaches learns in the act of teaching, and whoever learns teaches in the act of learning. So teaching and learning go hand in hand, and both teachers and learners learn, and learners teach teachers, teachers teach learners. So that's all from me. Thank you very much.
Madam.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for the wonderful session. There is a great deal of information on transformative versus medical, formative assessment, on four steps of assessment, and the whole methodology of learning also. Other changes that you have mentioned. Thank you so much for your time. And could you please take
it? No, voice check. Madam?
Yes.
Good morning, madam. This is Siva KK.
Yeah.
I am the moderator for question and answer session.
Okay.
First, let me thank you for giving such an insightful lecture into the assessment. I hope my voice is audible, madam.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Yeah, we have selected few questions for the want of time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I will read out the question, and if you feel like answering it immediately, you can answer it, or if it is comfortable for you to answer a few questions combinedly together, we'll go as you like.
Let's see, you just tell me one or two questions and we'll see whether they are.
Thank you, madam. But before we start the questions, even I have a doubt actually. I think you already mentioned about the CBSE exams. And you might have heard it, Tushar Singh, the guy who scored 500 out of 500 in the yesterday's CBSE results, had made a poignant comment that the CBSE should not give full marks in English. It has made headlines into newspapers today. So from the perspective of an assessor, how do you see this situation? I think this could be an initiation topic for our question and answer session.
Actually, yeah, but not quite within this, whatever we did today. But definitely, yeah, one comment I want to make. Long back when this group called Educational Initiatives did a study of the CBSE exams and other exams, there was one girl who had scored 95. Those days, 95 was very, very high. Not long ago, but then maybe 15 years ago. Nowadays, they get 98 and 100. In fact, she had been interviewed by India Today, and then her whatever excerpts from the interview were, you know, direct mentioned in that India Today article, which was based on this project that the Educational Initiatives did. And one was shocked to see the kind of English she spoke, having got the highest marks in CBSE exam. It was very faulty, very hardly conveyed anything properly, and then it was a very bad example of someone who had got 94. That actually speaks for it. So one thing is whether to give 100 or 95 or whatever, but the other thing is what do these 99 marks show? What do they reflect? They don't show language using ability. So that's where the problem.
So you mean to suggest that the assessment criteria or the evaluation criteria might have gone wrong?
The testing procedure, the kinds of tasks that are used, how many of them are just memorized tasks, all these need to be looked at.
Thank you very much, madam. One of, I think I would like to combine few questions which are which are running on the same lines. The question is like participants are asking how to take this formative assessment from traditional to online teaching, as we are now forced to do it, and then how to adapt it for the overcrowded classrooms. Can you show some light on it? We'll be happy.
I'm thinking aloud.
Once
you have identified the assessment situation, when you want to check, which is the most crucial point, when you have to check before you continue further, then you can have very easy ways of putting up the question on the board, or and then they will answer and give you a slip of paper. So let it be 100 students, let it be more than that, it doesn't matter, you have got it. And then you can have some kind of a color-coded thing to find out how many have got it right, how many haven't got it right. Can you proceed? Can you make a, do you need to make adjustments? So this is a very logistical kind of a thing. The simplest would be even to ask each one to hold a green piece of paper if they have understood. Orange, like not quite kind of a thing. A red one to say, no, I have not understood it at all. Then you need to do something about it. So assess evidence is, it could be reported evidence that what students are saying, yeah, I have understood. It could be actual evidence. Actual evidence is more difficult to get, but then you have, you can set up a small testing kind of a situation for maybe smaller classes. You can do that. Even online, you can do similar things. In fact, it online is it's easier.
We got it. Thank you. But there are a few questions they're asking for how to go about instructional adjustment based on our assessment, because in your chat you spoke about that that could be the final stage when we start doing assessment and making preparations to make a better formative assessment. So they want a more detailed clarity on that. In fact, even I would like to know like how I can make myself a better teacher by adjusting instruction.
Now, adjusting instruction is not the only thing which will make you a better teacher. When you follow this four-step process of formative assessment, identifying the assessment scene. I would have liked to go to the...
No problem.
No, just a minute. One, give me a second.
Sure, sure, ma'am. Take your time.
I want to show you that...
Slide, I understand.
Slide.
This one. Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Now here, you will need to select the four-step process. All are important. All the four steps are important. You need to identify an assessment occasion. The teacher is the best judge because this is a crucial point which determines where if many people are not clear about that concept of what you're teaching, then you shouldn't go further. So that is the assessment occasion. And then you will say how to do this procedure. Should it be actual assessment of knowledge, assessment of what they have learned, or can they say they have understood or they have not understood? Like I gave you the example of green, orange, and red. And then you actually look for evidence. How many have got it? This can be, it can be in the during the flow of a lecture, which is very tough to do, but then it can also be set up as an assessment exercise. Say 10 minutes of the class you are doing assessment to check whether this occasion has been met.
Okay.
You can sort of go through this point. So you look for that evidence through a formal or informal systematic kind of a process. So formative assessment, as Popham says, is not all that informal. That's why he's saying looking carefully at people or asking questions may be very informal, but then what he's talking about is a little more formal. So, of course, I don't 100% agree with this because we are constantly making instructional adjustments. If somebody is looking out of the window, we say something and we draw their attention. So that is an instructional adjustment. Maybe it is a classroom management based adjustment, but then there could be several things. But here he's talking about instructional adjustment. How do we do something differently this time, since I have understood that these many people haven't understood?
Yes.
So how do I tackle that problem?
Okay. So a kind of self-introspection do you suggest on the part of the teacher?
Also get students to reflect and retrospectively tell you what's working, what's not working. Once they become clear about this whole process, I think they will start telling you, now this is when I have not understood, I must let the teacher know about it. And so that the teacher just doesn't continue with it, and then the student will be lost otherwise.
Thank you, madam. And then there are questions related to the hole in the wall experiment. And I think I would put forward the first question that is quietly connecting Rousseau's philosophy of naturalism. The participant is asking, can we connect the experiments or understanding from the hole in the wall to Rousseau's naturalism, or even to the induction level of aspiration? Do you make any comment on that, madam?
I can't make a comment because I don't understand what is the second one. Rousseau's I do remember a little bit, naturalism. But what is the other one?
Induction level of aspiration.
I don't understand this, I'm sorry. So I can't make that connection.
I'm very sorry. Focusing on the aspirations of an individual, I guess. Okay, madam. We'll go to the next questions. And here is a question, actually. The results of that experiment also points out that a free hand to the learner to some extent.
Full extent.
Full extent. So that is actually giving scope for internet usage in the classroom or even in the examinations.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't it? But then doesn't it bring in some kind of risk, like unauthenticated and misleading information in the internet, and how discerning the learner can be? Or can the teacher intervene in this case and help the learner to choose right information from the internet? The audience would like to know about it.
See, I think open book exam is quite well known.
Yes.
Which is not the same exam as what we give, which is a closed book exam. Okay.
Yes.
So the kinds of questions that we have in an open book exam are very different, in the sense each one's answer will differ from the other one, and you even if you have open book, as in you can refer to books and then anything you want to kind of think, it won't give you a direct or easily, you can't answer it easily. So
yes.
The same way, if you are doing an internet-based exam, that not internet-based, you will allow internet to be used during exam. So the questions will be obviously very, very different. They will be more application-oriented, more critical. It's a personal viewpoint. You will need to argue how this is correct, that is not correct. So just the, what you get on the internet may not be enough. So you should have developed some kind of a higher level of understanding of things. And then if you need to look at internet, nobody should stop. For basic factual details and so on, you can look at internet. But if you're going to look at somebody else's similar answer and reproduce it there, you will have to be penalized. It will have to be your own original answer based on your understanding, but for which you may need to access some internet for factual details and factual information, and that should be allowed.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
plagiarism, of course, plays a big role here, especially when we are using internet. In fact, that thing has been introduced in all universities, plagiarism checks and everything. So even for assignments, you will need to introduce it, and definitely for exams as well.
Yes, Yes, madam. I think it calls in for a kind of awareness, raising awareness among the learners about plagiarism.
Yeah.
I think that will be falling.
And also,
Yes, madam.
And definitely it asks for a different set of questions, which are not at the very rudimentary level, but at a higher level. Not to say that we are taking the student higher and higher unnecessarily or anything. Because they have access to internet, they are already learning quite a lot. We need to acknowledge that.
Yes, ma'am. That's
true. And then build on it further.
All right, ma'am. I think we are, for the want of time, we'll take one more question. And if there are any further questions, we will post it to you. I think the participants will get them. One, Dr. Sunita Vijay Kumar is asking about how to bring in a kind of justifiably uniform way of testing in a world of dog race. I think it is beyond our purview in it, but
So I'll just read it again once more.
Yeah, the Sunita Vishikumar says that it's a world of competition and race for outperforming each other. So can we bring in any kind of justifiable uniform way, keeping all the tenets or parameters of good testing, especially in large classes?
See, large class, somehow that phrase figures in every discussion of ours, as though that is like a monster.
Yes.
I don't think it's a monster, and then we can handle it in very effective different ways. But what I want to focus on is, to some extent, tests will have to be uniform, because it's a common yardstick, and we want to judge whether everybody has reached on that common yardstick up to which point. So that we can do. But then we have no way very often to find out what else the student can do, which other areas they have learnt, and therefore where do they stand. So I think for that, at least, we will need more open-ended, more creative ways of finding out. And therefore, we need to move beyond. I'm not saying do away with these tests that we have usually used. I'm not talked about it, because we know enough about it, or we have discussed enough about it.
Yes.
But then we need to do something which we have not done so far, and therefore it seems like an unknown territory, but then we should try. That's what will transform our teaching and learning, in my view.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much, madam. That's been elaborate answer for all the questions. Dear participants, if there are any questions not taken for the want of time, we will post that to the madam, and as soon as we receive your answers, we'll get back to you. Thank you for that. Now, I request Mr. Paul Francis to propose a word of thanks.
Morning, everyone. We really enjoyed listening to your talk on transformative assessment. Madam, the inputs you have given will certainly help us to assess our students better hereafter. And we are looking forward for your tomorrow's talk. Thank you so much for spending your valuable time in clarifying the doubts of the participants also. Now, dear participants, you will not receive feedback form for today's session. You will get it tomorrow after Dr. Rama Matthew's session completes. Right? Please notice this. And you'll also get a separate link for tomorrow's session. Thank you all.